The Splendid Wayfaring, the story of the exploits and adventures of Jedediah Smith and his comrades, the Ashley Henry Men, discoverers and explorers of the great central route from the Missouri River to the Pacific Ocean, 1822 to 1831, by John G. Neihardt. This is a Librivox recording. All Librivox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit Librivox.org. Recording by Phil Schempf. The Splendid Wayfaring by John G. Neihardt. Preface. The student of American history in our schools is given an opportunity to become well acquainted with the early explorations of the Great Northwest and the Great Southwest. He is taught little or nothing of the real discoverers of the Central Route from the Missouri River to the Pacific Ocean. This is due to the fact that, until very recently, our historians have been concerned too much with governmental acts, too little with the activities of the people themselves. The official explorers of the Northwest and the Southwest were actually pioneers, but the official exploration of the great central region beyond the Rockies was undertaken 20 years after the actual discoverers and explorers had set out from St. Louis. Considering the fact that it was by way of the central route that the tide of migration flowed across the Rockies and possessed the far west, it would seem that the discovery and exploration of that route might now, at last, be given some attention in our schools. In the following pages I have told the story of that body of adventurers who, from 1822 to 1829, opened the way for the expansion of our nation beyond the Missouri. I have made Jedediah Smith the central figure of my story, for of all explorers of the Great West, he was in many ways the most remarkable, though heretofore our school children have not even heard his name. In order to give the student a sense of the continuity of history, I have begun my narrative with a brief account of the movement across the Alleghenies and down the Ohio River after the Revolutionary War. And I have suggested the relation of westward expansion in America to the whole race movement from the beginning. The general mood of a given period is quite as important a part of history as are the bare facts. Therefore, by way of giving a more vivid picture of the times, I have taken the liberty to supply minor details in chapters 1, 2, 4, 5, 8, 9, and 10, but in every case, I have done this strictly in accordance with the recorded experiences of contemporaries in similar situations. Also, as a matter of convenience in shaping the narrative, I have assumed that Smith went to St. Louis in the spring of 1822. There are good reasons for believing that this may be correct, though the year of his arrival there is unknown. In every other respect, the narrative faithfully follows the chain of facts as found in the authentic sources. Though I have drawn upon a considerable number of sources, as will be seen by consulting the bibliography at the back of the book, I am especially indebted to Professor Dale's admirable work, The Ashley Smith Explorations, which not only clears up some important points in the history of the period, but presents for the first time certain recently discovered documents bearing upon the expeditions of William H. Ashley and Jedediah Strong Smith. I must also acknowledge the following debts. To Mr. Doane Robinson, Secretary of the Historical Society of South Dakota, who, 12 years ago, revealed to me the wonderful life story of Jedediah Smith, and who has been most generous in furthering my work. To Miss Stella M. Drum, Librarian of the Missouri Historical Society, and to Mr. William E. Connolly, Secretary of the State Historical Society of Kansas, who have kindly furnished me with copies of source material placed in their keeping, to Mr. Frederick S. Dellenbaugh for permission to use pictures from his Canyon Voyage, and to Mr. Enos A. Mills, Dr. George Wharton James, and Professor S. H. Knight for photographs. John G. Neihardt, Bancroft, Nebraska, December 1919. End of the preface. Chapter 1 of The Splendid Wayfaring by John G. Neihardt. This Librivox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Phil Schempf. Down the Ohio. An early April dawn was whitening over the vast forests of Kentucky and Ohio, and here and there, From an occasional log cabin in a clearing, hearth smoke began to rise. Out of the dim wilderness to the east, the broad Ohio River, now swollen with the spring floods, came swirling down past the thriving little city of Cincinnati, set staunchly on a sunward slope. Already the city had awakened, but no auto horns honked, no trolley gongs clanged in the streets, and no whistle of an approaching locomotive disturbed the hush of the great valley. No railroad trains would arrive that day, nor for many a day thereafter. Though steamboats were now no longer uncommon, yet the bulk of the traffic was still carried on in a primitive way. This proud little metropolis of an immense territory, fabulously rich in all those material things that contribute to the happiness of men, knew nothing of telephones and telegraphs, or of any of those conveniences, without which an American city can no longer be conceived. And yet, during the day that was coming, as for a generation past, this bustling town would play its role in one of the most tremendous adventures that our race has experienced. What race and what adventures? In order to suggest the answer to this question, let us begin at the beginning, far back in the dim centuries, scanning as rapidly as possible what is, for us of the Western world, the greatest of all stories. Only thus can we sense the magnitude and significance of what we are about to witness. For there are no divisions in time, and history is to be conceived not as a succession of periods limited by dates on the calendar, but rather as one continuous process. Well then, thousands of years ago, the Aryan, or Indo-European race, dwelling in the valley of the Euphrates, was seized with the wanderlust. A portion of this people turned toward India. With those, we are not here concerned. A portion turned toward the setting sun, and so began a journey that should continue for thousands of years and thousands of miles, to reach our own Pacific coast during the 19th century. Those westering peoples were our ancestors. American history properly begins with them, and we today are the rightful heirs of all the heroism and beauty and wisdom that have been developed in their age-long pilgrimage. We are what we are because of what they experienced. Now, as those ancestors of ours pressed westward, they underwent many changes, owing to varying physical environment, to contact with other peoples, and to that evolution of ideas, which is the natural result of experience in meeting the difficulties of life. As we follow them in their westward migration, we know them under the guise of many nationalities, speaking as many different tongues. Yet the main line of descent runs clear. We might liken the ancient Aryan spirit to a prairie fire driven by an east wind out of Mesopotamia and destined to burn across the world. Now it flared up in Persia, and the gloom of the past is still painted with that flare. Now it was a white radiance in Greece, the clear illumination which still guides the feet of men. Now it burned ruddily in Rome and spread around the Mediterranean and became as a golden noonday to all the known world. Then it drove northward and lit Europe with a succession of illuminations. Now its glowing center was in the empire of Charlemagne, now in Spain under the great Philip, now in France under the grand monarch, now in England under Elizabeth, though whipped by cross winds and freakish gusts, changing ever by that upon which it fed, yet it was ever the same flame, ever yearning westward. In its rear, the ashes of fallen empires. In its van, the rising and falling light of what was yet to be. At last, borne as a torch by the discoverers and explorers of the Western Hemisphere, that flame was rekindled in our own colonial history. Up the Mississippi from the Gulf of Mexico came the Spaniards. Up the St. Lawrence forged the French. Westward across the Alleghenies and down the Ohio went the English and the Germans and the Dutch and the Irish. And all these scions of an ancient race were to meet and mingle in the great central valley, pushing on and on by river route and prairie trail and mountain pass to the waters of the Pacific. Here in the western continent, the wanderings of the widely dispersed peoples should end at last, and they were destined to become again one people. Thus it was that, on that April morning in 1822, the frontier city of Cincinnati was sharing in a great adventure, no less an adventure than the conquest of a continent. For a generation past, yonder river had been more than a stream of water. It had become a veritable stream of men, urged westward by the home hunger and the lure of wealth, impulses no less elemental than that which now flung the spring floods seaward. That morning at the city's waterfront, a clutter of boats, moored along the wagon-rutted landing, made clear in what manner the stream of men would flow that day. And what a variety of watercraft! There lay an ungainly side-wheeled steamboat, already belching smoke. Nearby was a stately barge, as big as an Atlantic schooner of those days, requiring at least 25 men to work it upstream. Yonder was a keelboat, long, slender, gracefully shaped, capable of bearing 30 tons of freight, and formed in such a way that it might easily be poled, towed by the cordel, or driven under sail when the wind was favorable, over the shallow waters of the summer season. Here again was a Kentucky flatboat, commonly known as a broadhorn. About 15 feet wide and 75 feet long, it would carry at least 60 tons. It was like an ark adventuring toward some Ararat in the country of the sunset, for it bore a whole family with all its worldly goods, geese, chickens, horses, cows, sheep, pigs, and there were Allegheny skiffs, carrying from 8 to 12 tons, pirogues hollowed out of enormous trees, common skiffs, dugouts, and various nondescript boats displaying a whimsical combination of well-known varieties. Now there is a bustling and babble of voices along the landing and among the cluttered craft. Neighborly messages are flung from deck to deck. Pioneers of Kentucky, hailing pioneers of the Mohawk Valley, Virginians and Pennsylvanians, discussing hopes with adventurers from the Maumee or Sandusky Bay or Green River. Traders with Yankee notions, tinware, pork, flour, hemp, tobacco, agricultural implements, and Monongahela whiskey for sale, question each other as to their cargoes and destinations among the Spanish and French settlements of the Mississippi. And how oddly clad these people are. Every member of yonder family on the Kentucky Broadhorn is dressed in linsey, and it is a safe guess that the mother, aided perhaps by the eldest daughter, has scutched, heckled, and spun the flax, carded and spun the wool, woven and dyed the cloth from which these garments were made. Many of the men wear the hunting shirt, a large-sleeved, loose frock, reaching halfway between hip and knee, open in front and wide enough to lap over a foot or more when closed with the belt that is tied in the back. A large cape, fringed perhaps with raveled cloth of a gaudy color, falls across the shoulders. Some of these shirts are made of linsey, some of linen, some of dressed deerskin. Breeches of buckskin fringed at the side seams are common, and there are more moccasins among these adventurers than shoes. The women, some of whom, no doubt, are destined to become the great-grandmothers of some of the proudest families of the West, have set off their rude homespun garments with no more conspicuous adornment than a small hand-woven handkerchief tied about the neck. Some are now going barefoot, some wear moccasins, some the coarsest of shoes. Few are the store clothes to be noted among these people, and indeed many of them, reared in the backwoods, had perhaps never seen a store until they came to stare at the sights in Cincinnati, a huge metropolis to them. Suddenly, above the babble, a boat horn strikes up a merry lilt. Others join in, and far away, like spirit bugles out of the dim past of the race, still sounding the westward advance, the echoes sing on among the wooded hills. With a roar from her whistle, the steamboat backs out, swings round, and thrusting her stubborn nose into the swirl, pushes on toward Pittsburgh, snorting like an asthmatic sleeper. The cumbrous barge, pulled by a dozen brawny men, moves slowly outward, feels the clutch of the current, and sweeps away. The ark-like broadhorn follows, while, startled by the shouting of the men and the blaring of the horns, the geese and chickens and sheep and cows and pigs and horses add each their own peculiar cries to the general din. And indeed, why should they not be heard? Have they not shared as comrades in the age-long adventure of the race? Skiffs, pirogues, and dugouts are putting off. The keelboat's line is taken in, The patron, as the helmsman is called, is at the wheel. The crew makes ready to push off and join the flotilla, now swirling rapidly down the stream. The last passenger is going aboard, a slender, dark-haired young man of middle height, with an erect, alert bearing and a keenness of the eye that betokens resolution and intelligence. He must be well under 25 years of age. His clothes are of homespun, and he carries upon his back a plunder bag, doubtless containing all his worldly wealth. Let us follow him, for though yonder French boatman with his scarlet sash seems by far the more important person of the two, this young fellow, with the bag at his back, is fated to become one of the great torch-bearers of the race, and within 9 years he shall have pushed far in advance of the oncoming human tide, discovering a main route of travel through the western wilderness to the Pacific Ocean, encountered many perils, and died the death of a hero, leaving as a legacy to his countrymen the memory of his years, as rich as they were few. Now the keelboat was in midstream, and soon the town was lost to view around a bend. Sitting on his plunder bag on the forward deck, the young man gazed dreamily at the two green worlds that flowed by him, a vision of universal fruitfulness. The magnificent beeches and sycamores and cottonwoods along the shore were in full leaf. Red birds flickered with mellow whistlings in and out among the dense foliage. Now and then a flock of parakeets shocked some green silence with eruptions of color and noise. Columns of smoke arose from occasional cabins in some hidden clearing beyond the dense wood that fringed the river. Axe strokes, begetting multitudes of echoes, told where some lusty backwoodsman was contributing his share of labor to the making of a new world. Dogs barked far away, and echo-dogs answered in the golden hush. During the morning they had passed the mouth of the great Miami on their right, and shortly afterward the village of Lawrenceburg. Now and then a bend in the river revealed a patch of cleared ground, wherein a barefooted ploughman drove his team of oxen among the stumps, and then there arose a running fire of question and answer between the boats and the shore. The colloquy might run somewhat as follows. "Hello, the boat!" "Hello, the plough! Have you any potatoes to sell the boat?" "None. Have you any whiskey aboard the boat?" "Plenty." "Well, I'll trade potatoes for whiskey."
"What do you ask for your potatoes?"
$1 a bushel."
"Too much."
"Well, I'll let you have a bushel of potatoes for a gallon of whiskey."
The boats move on.
"Half a gallon."
The voice grows dimmer with increasing distance.
"A quart."
Or perhaps the conversation between boatmen and the settler might call forth what passed for Yankee wit, as, for instance,
"Curious settler, where are you from?"
"Facetious boatman."
"Redstone."
"What's your lading?"
"Millstones."
"What's the captain's name?"
"Whetstone."
"Where are you bound?"
"Limestone."
Sometimes it is said such dialogues between land and water developed into an exchange of blackguardly epithets, ending, as like as not, in the landing of the boatmen and a brisk fight on shore. Nor should this greatly surprise us, for always at the lip of the advancing human flood the brawling and turbulent spirits are sure to be found. And indeed the race owes much to its wild and reckless types, for from their number have been recruited the rank and file of many a daring expedition into the wilderness, to the end that the way might be made clear for the homemakers. The race advances through its exceptions, that is to say, through those who refuse to think or act in accordance with established custom, those whose departures from what has been accepted as right prove at last to be advantageous to the race, become the great men, and are justly honored. The others are overcome and forgotten. At one end of this scale of human exceptions we find the saint and the seer, at the other end the criminal. Many of those turbulent spirits that were of the greatest value in the pioneering age would, if confined to the uncongenial environment of a modern industrial city, end their days in a penitentiary. The sun rose high above the drifting flock of boats and began the long descent of afternoon. Still the young man sat upon his plunder bag, or paced about the keelboat's deck, dreamily watching the rich bottom lands and rolling hills drift past. No wonder that he had little heart for entering into the gay spirit of his fellow travelers. He was leaving home, and there was something inexorable about the swift and silent current that bore him farther and farther into a world unknown to him. And yet there must have been a thrill in it all, for he had dreamed a daring dream of what a resolute young man might do in those vast, mysterious white spaces that then made up the greater portion of the map of the Trans-Missouri country. Doubtless, rivers and mountains and lakes had been waiting yonder for unknown ages for a white man to discover and name them. Might he not prove to be that white man? And beyond those vast white spaces lay the Pacific Ocean and the country of the Spaniards. 17 years before, Lewis and Clark had pushed to the headwaters of the Missouri, across the mountains to the headwaters of the Columbia, and down that river to the sea. But what of the way through the great country to the south? Who should find and plot it? The setting sun glowed across the broad flood ahead, and the full moon rose, huge and red, through the mists of the valley in the rear. It would be a white night. The high water made the river safe, and so the boats floated on into the deepening moony haze. Suppers were cooked and eaten. Then a squeaking fiddle struck up a familiar backwoods tune on board the Kentucky Broadhorn. Soon a dance was in full swing there, and the young men and women from the other boats were putting off in skiffs to join the merrymaking. Now and then, bursts of song and shouts of laughter drowned out the clatter of heels and the shrill ecstasies of the racing fiddle. But the young man, whom we have been noting, showed no inclination to join the merrymakers. He had been reading a book by the lingering twilight, until the dusk had blotted out the dog-eared pages. Then he began pacing up and down the deck, his head bowed, his hands clasped behind him. And seen thus in the moonlight, he seemed more like an old man brooding upon the dead years than a youth whose blood pulsed strongly with the lust of high adventure. By and by, the patron at the helm, a sturdy old graybeard from the Monongahela, hailed him. "What book, young man? One of them love yarns, I'll warrant."
"I was reading the great book, sir."
"Eh? The Scriptures?
A great book indeed. And them as be kicking their heels in the devil's wind yonder might better be reading of it.
Where bound?"
"To St. Louis."
"What you calculate doing yonder?"
"I shall enter the fur trade."
"Aye, and go far, I'll warrant, for I see you be one of them as knows where they're going, keeps a tight lip and goes there by the grace of God. That breed goes far. Most ain't rightly sure where they be bound, and never gets there, like me. My beard's gray, and I bean't there yet, and so I know. Who be you? Where you from, and who's your folks?" Now even to the most taciturn and self-contained young man who was leaving home, that is likely to be a stimulating question, and the old patron got his answer. Our young hero's name was Jedediah Strong Smith. His father, Jedediah Smith, a native of New Hampshire, had pushed westward into the Mohawk Valley with the first wave of emigration after the close of the Revolutionary War, and had settled in Chenango County, New York. There in the village of Bainbridge, on June 24, 1798, our hero was born. But in spite of his large and growing family, the elder Smith had not long remained there, for the wanderlust of the race had been strong in him, and the lure of the sunset that was to lead his son across the plains and mountains and deserts even to the waters of the Pacific had led the father still farther to the west. For a few years the family had lived in Erie, Pennsylvania, and was now settled in Ashtabula, Ohio, with little prospect of moving any farther, for the children at home now numbered a baker's dozen. Though the chances for education in the country of his childhood were slight in those days, Jed had been fortunate in making friends with a physician, Dr. Simmons, who had given him the rudiments of an English education and a smattering of Latin, together with a love for the Scriptures and the fear of God. At the age of 13, Jed had begun to shift for himself, having secured a job as clerk on one of the freight boats of the Great Lakes. Thus, at an impressionable age, he had come in close contact with the traders and trappers of the British fur companies, and the many stirring tales he had heard from those adventurers had determined the course of his life. He too would brave the dangers of the wilderness. So now he was going to St. Louis, the great emporium of the American fur trade. The moon rose high,
and still the old patron and the young adventurer talked of the western country, of St. Louis, and of the bright prospects that the fur trade then offered to enterprising young men. At midnight, the old man's watch ended, and another took the helm. Rolling themselves in their blankets, the gray beard and the youth lay down upon the forward deck to sleep. By and by, the sound of merrymaking on the broad horn trailed away into a great silence, and all night long the shadowy helmsman, guiding the black hulks through the mysterious immensity, sailed astonished amid the stars. Boat horns called to the sleepers as the fleet drifted slowly out of the fading shadow into a new day. Once again, neighborly voices were heard crying from deck to deck. The fleet was now drifting southwestwardly, with the Indiana shore to starboard. Close on noon, it passed the Kentucky River, flowing bank full out of the primeval forest to the southeast. Here a rude flatboat, that had been moored among the willows near the junction of the streams, put off and floated in among the other boats. It bore a large family with all its household goods, bound for the Wabash country, a fact which did not long remain a secret, for the meeting of pioneers involved no ceremony, and the father, who with the aid of a lank, overgrown, frowsy-headed boy, guided his drifting home with a long sweep-oar at the stern, was at once subjected to a running fire of questions. The course of the river shifted to the northwest, then to the west, then to the south. Dusk came, and the moon rose. All afternoon there had been much talk of the falls of the Ohio, now some 40 miles ahead, over which the fleet must pass. Those who were traveling that way for the first time naturally looked forward with dread to the fancied dangers of the passage, though the old-timers assured them that in high water there was nothing to fear. Nevertheless, in the wee hours of the morning, the boats put in to shore, there to await the dawn, that the falls might be passed in daylight. It was mid-forenoon when the lookout on the leading boat, then drifting near Louisville in waters as smooth as a lake, heard a deep roaring ahead. A cry of warning arose and spread over the fleet, dying out suddenly as the first boat rocked to the clutching swirl, leaped into a stretch of wildly agitated waters, and shot out into the glassy quiet below. It was all over in a few minutes, but when the boats once more drifted in the dozing calm, the laughter of relaxing dread and the pointless jests that were bandied from deck to deck told how tense those minutes had been. There was now no obstacle to fear in the whole course of the Ohio, and favored by the moon, the fleet continued to drift by night as well as by day, save when an occasional rainstorm darkened the sky. Now and then a stop was made at some settlement for the purpose of trading for supplies and getting acquainted. Some of the craft dropped out of the fleet at various points, and others took their places. One day and night below the falls, they passed Blue River on their right. In 3 more days, they saw the Green River coming in out of Kentucky. Another day and night brought them to the mouth of the Wabash, and at noon of the following day, they landed at Shawnee Town, an unpleasant-looking little village, set upon low ground and now struggling with the floodwaters. In spite of its appearance, however, it was then, and had been for years, a place of some importance, owing to the salt deposits nearby, which furnished its chief article of commerce, and to the fact that it had become an outfitting point for the Mississippi trade. Here the keelboat, which bore our hero, took on 9 French boatmen to aid in the difficult task of poling and cordelling from the mouth of the Ohio to St. Louis. Now the river broadened. The bluffs began to fall away. Cultivated patches became less frequent. Dismal stretches of swampland, haunted by waterfowl, were more and more common. To right and left, the lofty forest stretched away with a regular surface like a vast green roof, supported by huge living columns rising out of the water. At rare intervals, the solitary cabin of a woodcutter, set on piles or blocks to raise it above the inundation, served by contrast to make the scene more dismal. A day and night from Shawnee Town, the mouth of the Cumberland was passed, and half a day later the Tennessee. The next sunrise found them moored at the junction of the 2 great rivers. Yonder magnificent stream was the Mississippi, and young Smith, gazing upon it for the first time, doubtless felt something of awe and the sense of losing a friendly world made dear with old associations that the ancient Phoenician mariners must have experienced at the Pillars of Hercules. Here at the Delta, speculators had once dreamed of founding a great commercial city, and a few houses had been raised on piles. But the dream had failed, and now the town was kept on a huge flatboat, 100 feet long, in which there were stores, liquor shops, gambling dens, and a motley population of miserable men and women, a trap of vice for the unwary. Here was the central point of the most extensive network of navigable rivers on the globe, a natural system of transportation that has not even now, at the end of the second decade of the 20th century, been fully utilized to the advantage of mankind. Keelboats and flat-bottomed mackinaws, starting at this point, could ascend to the headwaters of the Mississippi, to the Great Falls of the Missouri, in sight of the Rocky Mountains, to Pompey's Pillar on the Yellowstone, to the state of New York by way of the Ohio River, up the Illinois and down to Chicago to the Great Lakes, up the Wabash and the Tennessee into the heart of the great forests, or descending to the Red River of the South or the Arkansas, it was possible to penetrate the great prairie wilderness of the Southwest, even to the Spanish country. Already the traffic that passed this point was immense, considering the undeveloped condition of the country. A short distance to the south, at the mouth of the bayou, was the port of New Madrid, and there, in a single spring day, as many as 100 boats had landed, laden with planks from the pine forests of southwestern New York, Yankee notions, corn in the ear, apples and potatoes from Ohio, pork, flour, whiskey, hemp, tobacco, bagging and bale rope from Kentucky, cotton from Tennessee, cattle and horses from Missouri and Illinois. Sometimes a number of these craft would be lashed together, thus forming a floating town, several acres in extent, and brisk was the trade, and merry the festivities that were carried on in such drifting communities. Now began the most difficult part of the voyage to St. Louis, a stretch of approximately 200 miles against the full spring flood. The cordel, or tow line, swung from the masthead of the keelboat, was flung ashore, and a dozen boatmen, toiling tandem with the line across their shoulders, began the long pull northward, while the helmsman at the stern and a polesman at the bow kept the craft well out in the stream. Timothy Flint, an early traveler by keelboat up this difficult stretch, has left us the following general remarks regarding the labors and dangers attendant upon such a voyage in those days. Owing to the character of the river and the numberless impediments in it and on its banks, the cordel is continually entangling among the snags and sawyers between the boat and the shore, and has often to be thrown over small trees and carried around larger ones. Sometimes you are impeded by masses of trees that have lodged against the sawyers. At other times you find a considerable portion of the shore, including a surface of acres that has fallen into the river, with all its trees upon it. Just at the edge of these trees, the current is so heavy as to be almost impassable. It is beside the question to think of forcing the boat up against the main current anywhere, except with an uncommon number of hands. Therefore, any impediment near the shore must either be surmounted or the river crossed to avoid it. It often happens that the boat, with no small labor and falling downstream with the strength of the current, crosses to avoid such difficulties and finds equal ones on the opposite shore. Sometimes you are obliged to make your way among the trunks of the trees, the water boiling round your boat like a mill race. Then if the boat swings, you are instantly carried back, and perhaps strike the snags below you, and your boat is staved. I do not remember to have traversed this river in any considerable trip without having heard of some fatal disaster to a boat, or having seen the dead body of some boatman, recognized by the red flannel shirt which they generally wear. The number of carcasses of boats lying at the points or thrown up high and dry on the wreck heaps demonstrate how many are lost on this wild and, as the boatmen call it, wicked river. All day long, under such difficulties, with brief but frequent breathing spells, the crew fought its way upstream. And always the hardest task was met with song, for the French boatmen were famous singers, peculiarly gifted with the genius for lightheartedness. Often it became necessary for all, save the helmsman, to take a hand in the tense struggle with the sinewy current. And during the 15 days from the mouth of the Ohio to St. Louis, young Smith learned much of upstream travel that was soon to stand him in good stead. But however arduous the long days might be, the evenings were a delight, for then, with a campfire roaring under some spreading tree, The boatmen would vie with each other in recounting the adventures that had befallen them. Some had been in the upper Missouri River country 3,000 miles away, and had heard the great falls singing thunderously to the empty spaces. Others had penetrated the forest wilderness above the falls of St. Anthony. Still others had reached the Spanish country by way of the Red River or the Arkansas. One had been to Santa Fe and high-walled Taos, and he remembered weird tales of deserted prehistoric cities in the mountain fastnesses beyond the Spanish peaks. Another had been in the headwaters of the Yellowstone and seen Coulter's Hell, a vast patch of earth where the good God was still at work amidst primeval fire and steam and brimstone. And as this man talked, some smiled incredulously, for he seemed as one who lies blithely for his own amazement. And perhaps he did. Perhaps they all did in some degree. Always at the first peep of day, the battle with the river began again. They passed the turbulent waters between the Grand Tower and the Devil's Oven. The Cornice Rock dropped behind them, and the perilous point called the Sycamore Root became an unpleasant memory. Now they toiled slowly past the mouth of the Kaskaskia, upon which, a few miles inland, stood an important old town of the same name, a pleasant village, and proud to be remembered that it once entertained the great friend of liberty, Lafayette. Now the whitewashed mud walls and wooden crosses of St. Genevieve were seen on the Missouri side, a mile up the little creek called Gaborone. To the eastward were the rich alluvial lands of the American bottom, and there the scattered farmsteads of the petite paysans, or small planters, made the landscape pleasant. More days of grueling labor, and they saw the shot towers of Herculaneum set high on the bluffs to the west. Past the mouth of the Merrimack they forged slowly, past the thriving villages of Carondelet and Cahokia. Then at last, 15 days after they had left the mouth of the Ohio, they saw the city of St. Louis rising gradually from the water's edge up the flanks of the westward bluffs, and at a distance it was like a seated throng viewing from a spacious amphitheater the pageant of the westering peoples. End of chapter 1. Chapter 2 of The Splendid Wayfaring by John G. Neihardt. This Librivox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Phil Schempf. At St. Louis. When Jedediah Smith first walked the streets of St. Louis, the town was nearly 60 years old, and its motley population of Spanish, French, and Americans numbered somewhat less than 5,000. Though its advantageous position near the central point of a vast system of waterways had made it an important settlement from the time of its founding, yet it had shown little progress until after that day in March 1804, when in the course of 24 hours it had flown in succession the flags of Spain, France, and the United States, in token of the passing sovereignty of the great territory of Louisiana. Shortly thereafter, Lewis and Clark had undertaken their famous exploring expedition to the mouth of the Columbia, and the influx of Americans had begun. The Yankee spirit soon transformed the general aspect of the old town. Whereas before, most of the houses were frame structures, daubed with mud and whitewashed, or built of stone in the rough and coated with mortar, brick houses had begun to appear, until in 1819, as a traveler of the time informs us, lines of buildings containing handsome and spacious city houses were to be seen, houses that would not have disgraced Philadelphia. In 1817, the first steamboat, the Pike, arrived, and in 1819, the Independence made the trip to Franklin and back, the first power boat to sail the Missouri River. During the same year, the Western Engineer, bearing the exploring party of Major Long, ascended to a point near the present city of Omaha. But though the development of steamboat navigation continued steadily from that time on, it was not until the year 1831 that steamboats began to ascend the Missouri as far as the mouth of the Yellowstone, and all traffic on the upper reaches of the Missouri was still by keelboats and Mackinaws. After the transfer of Louisiana to the United States, the fur trade, which had been the chief industry of the town from the beginning, had soon increased in volume as the result of American enterprise. On March 12, 1811, the Overland Astorians, under the command of W. P. Hunt, had left St. Louis, bound for the mouth of the Columbia, where they expected to join forces with a sea expedition that had left New York Harbor on the ship Tonquin early in September of the previous year for the long and hazardous voyage around the Horn. The tale of the Astorians, as told by Washington Irving, is one of the masterpieces of American literature. During the War of 1812, the fur trade had declined, and though in the year 1819 five companies of some importance were operating from St. Louis, the chief of these being the Missouri Fur Company, headed by the veteran Spanish trader Manuel Lisa, yet none of these was doing a profitable business. However, Jed had arrived at a most auspicious time, just when the tide, having reached its lowest ebb, had begun to turn. The great Manuel Lisa, who had for many years operated on the Upper Missouri and Yellowstone, had died 2 years before and had been succeeded by Joshua Pilcher as head of the Missouri Fur Company, which, however, was then nearing the end of its history. In 1821, Pilcher had established a new trading post at the mouth of the Bighorn, but a few weeks before Smith's arrival, the company had sent out a party of 180 trappers under Jones and Immel, bound for the Upper Missouri country. Though successful at the start, this expedition was doomed to meet disaster at the hands of the Blackfeet near the forks of the Missouri, and its two leaders were never to return. It is not in keeping with our purpose to follow here the failing fortunes of the old Missouri Fur Company, though the bare factual story of that organization is packed with the precious stuff of which great epics are made. What does concern our purpose is a brief paragraph that had appeared in the Missouri Republican for March 20th, 1822, less than 2 months before the arrival of our hero. It ran as follows. To enterprising young men, the subscriber wishes to engage 100 young men to ascend the Missouri River to its source, there to be employed for 1, 2, or 3 years. For particulars, inquire of Major Andrew Henry, near the lead mines in the county of Washington, who will ascend with and command the party, or of the subscriber near St. Louis. Signed, William H. Ashley. The names there given could not but inspire the greatest confidence among the adventurous young spirits of that time and place. Major Henry, born in Fayette County, Pennsylvania, during the early part of the Revolutionary War, had descended the Ohio in his mid-twenties. He was one of the incorporators of the Missouri Fur Company in 1809, and in the spring and summer of that year had led an expedition up the Missouri to the Three Forks, where a trading post had been established. Driven thence by the terrible Blackfeet, he had crossed the Continental Divide and built a fort on what has since been called Henry's Fork of the Snake River, thus being the first American trader to operate west of the Rockies. Having spent there the winter of 1810-11, Henry, finding this position also extremely difficult, if not impossible, to hold against the Indians, had returned to St. Louis during the following summer. For 10 years now, he had been engaged in lead mining, and had come to be known as Andrew Henry of the Mines. But the stories of his adventures beyond the Great Divide still passed from mouth to mouth, and we may be sure that they had lost nothing of wonder in the passing. Though William Henry Ashley had not yet ventured into the wilderness, yet his name had become one to conjure with. Born in Powhatan County, Virginia, in 1778, he had settled in St. Louis in 1802, where he seems very soon to have won prominence. He was made captain of the Missouri Militia in 1813, colonel in 1819, and was now general. 2 years before, he had been elected lieutenant governor of the state, but recently admitted to the Union. It is not surprising that these illustrious names, together with a new spirit of adventure that was in the air, should have brought a ready response to the advertisement above quoted. Within a fortnight, the 100 young men had been enrolled, many of whom, as a local paper remarked at the time, had relinquished the most respectable employments and circles of society for the dangers and hardships of wilderness life. And what men they were! Fate seems just then to have been in an especially artistic mood, bent upon plotting their story on an epic scale, to this end choosing the most heroic spirits of an heroic age, dooming them to wanderings that should make those of Odysseus and Aeneas seem mere pleasure jaunts, preparing amazing adventures for them to encounter, mighty deeds that they should do, and for many, strange and tragic ends. On April 15, 1822, some 3 weeks before Jed Smith, their future comrade and leader, had set foot upon the St. Louis landing, these 100 men, with 2 keelboats loaded with trapping supplies and goods for the Indian trade, had begun the long ascent of the Missouri, under the leadership of Major Henry. General Ashley had accompanied them, intending to ascend to the mouth of the Yellowstone and return to the States in the fall. The first objective of the expedition was the Three Forks of the Missouri, where, as rumor had it, existed a wealth of furs not surpassed by the mines of Peru. From thence, trapping parties would work the creeks and rivers on both sides of the Great Divide, and if circumstances should prove favorable, the party would later move on down the trail of Lewis and Clark, even to the mouth of the Columbia. One can easily imagine what must have been Jed's regret upon hearing everywhere the eager talk about the 2 great expeditions that had so recently started for the mountains. If he had only come a month earlier, he might even now be far up the river in pursuit of his dream. But perhaps it was just as well after all. With his experience as a clerk on the lake boats of the British fur traders, he found no difficulty in getting employment in an office of one of the St. Louis companies, where he might have the opportunity of becoming familiar with American methods of business. Nor was his great dream idle during the long summer that followed. In any tavern of the town, one might meet old Spanish and French veterans of the wilderness, some of whom, no doubt, had been with Lisa at the Three Forks, some with Henry beyond the Rockies, and some must have known the Spanish country and been to Santa Fe. Many were the tales of Indian fights, hairbreadth escapes, and well-nigh incredible sufferings from hunger and thirst that these would tell, provided they were first well-warmed with the liquor of their liking. Little by little, Jed was able to pick up much of what seemed to be fairly dependable geographical information regarding the Great Northwest and the Great Southwest, all of which he carefully noted on a crude map of the period. But there was a vast triangular space, with its apex somewhere in the upper Platte region, one leg extending to the Columbia's mouth and the other reaching out toward the Gulf of California, that remained white in spite of all his inquiries. Now and then, some old-timer, whose creative faculty had been somewhat overstimulated, would remember that he once met a man whose name he did not recall, who had heard from someone much about that interior country. Nevertheless, no information was forthcoming that Jed might record within that immense blank triangle, the country of his dream. And so, during the summer of 1822, the dream was nurtured with mystery and grew mighty. Nor was Jed the only dreamer in St. Louis. It was an era of dreaming, for the lure of easy wealth was in the air and had fastened like an enchantment upon all men. One had only to get far enough away from the States to find, in inexhaustible quantities and with all the circumstances of romance, the means for realizing one's wildest dream. Somewhere out yonder, all the streams swarmed with beaver, the price of which was rising rapidly. The fur fever was raging now, just as the gold fever would rage a little over a quarter of a century later, and after that, the homestead fever. In its issue for September 17th, the Intelligencer of St. Louis published an article in which the following paragraph occurred. Those formerly engaged in the trade have increased their capital and extended their enterprises. Many new firms have engaged in it, and others are preparing to do so. It is computed that 1,000 men, chiefly from this place, are now employed on the waters of the Missouri, and half that number on the upper Mississippi. Men were in a mood for hearing big stories that summer and fall. In the absence of reports from the upper country, rumor worked overtime, and it seemed like nearly every able-bodied man Jed met had set his heart upon going to the mountains next year. Then one day, during mid-October, came what seemed to be an unqualified corroboration of the wildest rumors. In the golden autumn doze, a fleet of rude Mackinaws, under the command of Captain Perkins of the Missouri Fur Company, came drifting down from the mouth of the Missouri and tied up at the St. Louis landing. They had made the dangerous trip from the upper waters of the far-off Yellowstone, and they were laden with costly beaver packs, $24,000 worth of fur. The news of their coming had traveled across country from St. Charles on the Missouri, and all St. Louis, it seemed, was crowded along the waterfront to welcome this Jason and his crew returning with the Golden Fleece. Gaunt with toil and privations, long-haired and bewhiskered, bronzed with the sun and wind of the wilderness, and clad in savage garb, these men were received as conquerors are received. Bells rang in all the steeples. Guns roared up and down the riverfront. Dogs barked. Men shouted and sang. Far into the night the celebration continued. Bonfires flared. Liquor flowed freely. For this was more than a triumph, alas, the last, of the old Missouri Fur Company. It was, in a sense, the first, though vicarious, triumph of many a dreamer's dream. A week later, another and smaller party arrived in Mackinac. It was General Ashley, with a handful of men returning from the mouth of the Yellowstone. Once again St. Louis thronged the waterfront, but the manner of his reception, though hearty enough, no doubt lacked something of the fervor that the arrival of Captain Perkins had aroused, for Ashley's party came with empty hands, and the story they had to tell must have seemed like an anticlimax. The 100 enterprising young men, led by Major Henry, had made their way in good time to the mouth of the Yellowstone, over 2,000 miles away, and there, on the tongue of land between the two rivers, they had begun to build a fort, from whence, as a base, trapping parties might operate. But ill fortune had not been lacking. While still in the state of Missouri, some 2 days below the mouth of the Kansas River, one of the keelboats, heavily laden with valuable goods, had become unmanageable while crossing the turbulent stream, and drifting against a snag, had been staved and sunk. No lives had been lost, but the cargo, valued at $10,000, had gone to the bottom. Nevertheless, the party had forged ahead without much delay. For weeks thereafter, fate seemed to have been propitiated by the one sacrifice below the Kansas. At the villages of the Ree Indians, near the mouth of the Grand River in what is now South Dakota, Major Henry had spent several days in successful trade for horses, and had met no difficulty there, though the Rees had earned a reputation for treachery among the early traders. But in the month of August, when the party had passed the Mandan towns, a band of Assiniboines had no doubt been spying upon the Americans for days, had swooped down upon the impotent horse guards at a time when the main body with the keelboat had crossed with the channel to the opposite shore. 50 horses that had but recently been purchased from the Rees were driven away, while nearly 100 men, well armed but out of range, gazed across the waste of sand and water and raged to no purpose. But in spite of these initial disasters, Ashley was not discouraged. With 100 men already in the fur country, he pointed out that success was only a matter of persistence, and announced his intention of leading a second party upriver early in the spring. Among those who enlisted for the great adventure was Jedediah Smith. End of chapter 2.
Chapter 3 of The Splendid Wayfaring by John G. Neihardt. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Phil Schempf. Northbound with the Robins. It was on the 10th of March, 1823, that General Ashley started again for the Upper Missouri with 100 men and 2 keelboats, Yellowstone Packet and the Rocky Mountains. And with him went Jedediah Smith, in pursuit of a dream grown mighty. The new grass was like a pale green flame, burning slowly up the sloughs, and the young leafage of the cottonwoods was a thin smoke against the sky that day, when they started north with the Robins. Singing they went, for these 100 men were young, with the spirit of adventure, and that is still the youngest thing in the world, though it was already ancient when history began. The rattle of musketry and the shouting along the levee grew dim, and many a youngster, looking back, saw for the last time the smoke of the home fires pluming skyward. Some were to disappear, like yonder heath reek,
leaving no hint of the manner of their passing, and others, bewitched by the wild life and the vast free spaces of the wilderness, would shed, as an uncomfortable coat, the inheritance of ages, lapsing into the primitive, never again to long for the snug comforts and predetermined ways of civilized man. A day and a night passed, and their boats, swinging westward, had crossed the agitated line that, like a tide rip, marks the thrust of the impetuous Missouri against the slower might of the Mississippi. At St. Charles, farewells were said once more, and then, day by day, signs of civilization became less frequent. From the mouth of the Kansas, where the western boundary of the states then ran, the spring, still young, as at St. Louis, led them north. Or did their advance progressively awaken the spring? For weeks, it seemed, the wonder work made no progress. As it had been at the Kansas, so it was at the Platte and at the Sioux, for the young men and the young sun and the warm south winds were traveling together. Though these adventurers were now well beyond the frontiers of civilization, yet it must not be inferred that they were the only white men in that portion of the great Missouri Valley. Here and there along the river, from its mouth to the Three Forks, were scattered many trading posts of varying importance. Above the Kansas, they had passed a considerable number of such establishments. There was one at the Black Snake Hills, founded by old Joseph Roubideau, near the site of the present St. Joseph. There was the old trading house of the Choteaus at the mouth of the Nishnabotna. In the region of the Platte's mouth, they had seen the post built during the previous year by Joshua Pilcher of the Missouri Fur Company. Some 15 miles further up was old Fort Lisa, then about to be abandoned. 5 miles beyond that, near the point where Lewis and Clark held their famous council with the Oto and the Missouri Indians, stood Fort Atkinson, then the northernmost military post of the United States on the Missouri River. It was commanded at that time by Colonel Leavenworth, who was soon to win doubtful laurels as the leader of the Missouri Legion in the Ree campaign. There were American traders at Blackbird Hill, near the old mud village of the Omaha Indians, and at the mouth of the Big Sioux, where Sioux City now stands, the American Fur Company maintained a house. At most of these points, Ashley's men had rested long enough to exchange gossip, fresh from the States, for news from the great upper country. On into the north they forged, with pole and oar and sail and cordel. But now it was May, and the pale green spring somehow began to outpace them at last, though they could not say just when they had dropped behind. The grass in the sloughs seemed suddenly to have deepened and darkened, and the full-leafed cottonwoods were ready for the heavy heat of the summer, as yet withheld. Past the mouth of the Vermilion they toiled, past the Riviera Jacques, past Ponca Post, where the fleet Niobra assails the Missouri with a roar and hurls it back despite its greater mass. They were now in the country of the powerful Sioux tribe, which, though destined to make the last great stand of all the prairie peoples against the westering Aryan 40 years later, was still friendly to the whites. Hitherto, the northward march of Ashley's party had seemed little more than a pleasure jaunt, for though the labor at the cordel was no child's play, it was divided among 100 men, and no unforeseen obstacles had been encountered. But soon they were to hear that which should put a new face upon the whole adventure, shatter the illusions of the attenuated Pussy Willow Spring. At noon one day, they toiled past the White River coming in on their left, and when the sun was level with the bluffs, they swung around a right-hand bend and paused to shout. There, a little way ahead of them, was American Island, green with cedars, and at its lower point stood Fort Recovery, the Sioux trading post of the Missouri Fur Company, a cluster of log cabins surrounded by a wall of sharpened pickets. Many of Ashley's party and the men at the fort had known each other since boyhood, and it is easy to imagine how the evening was spent. But the news that the newcomers received in return for the latest gossip from home was hardly reassuring. The Rees, it appeared, were in a bad mood. 2 months before, a band of over 100 had boldly entered the Sioux country, robbed a party of white traders, and encouraged by this initial success, had attacked the fort. In the brisk battle that followed, several of the Indians had been wounded, and 2 had been killed, one of the latter being the son of a chief. Since that time, persistent rumors had been coming downstream to the effect that the tribe intended to leave its villages near the mouth of the Grand, join forces with the Mandans near the mouth of the Knife, and resist any attempt on the part of the traders to pass that point. The assembled parties at Fort Recovery could not know that this apparently unwarranted flare-up of the Rees was not merely a matter of whim on the part of that particular people. It was, in fact, symptomatic of a widespread spirit of opposition among the tribes of a vast region, due to the large number of traders that were entering the country with the revival of the fur trade. It could not be known that far away at the Three Forks, Jones and Immel, who had gone out with 180 men during the previous spring, were even then approaching death and disaster at the hands of the Blackfeet, and that bad news was already on the way from Henry on the Upper River. But even considering the affair solely as a matter of re-caprice, and assuming that the Mandans had no notion of joining forces with their neighbors to the south, Ashley was confronted with a dilemma. The Ree villages were strongly fortified and commanded the river. It appeared that a wedge was about to be driven between the ascending party and Henry at the Yellowstone's mouth, for the overland trip was, of course, impossible without many pack horses, and only among the Rees themselves, it was thought, could a number sufficient for such an undertaking be found. The only course possible was to run the gauntlet of the Indian villages with the boats. After all, the mood of the Rees might have changed by now, and there was much in the history of the tribe to justify such a hope, for no trader ever knew which way the wind of their whim might blow. Accordingly, the early dawn saw Ashley's hundred moving northward again. 4 days passed by without any noteworthy incident, and then at noon on the fifth day, when they were nearing the mouth of the Cheyenne, an express arrived with news from their comrades in the upper country. Things had not been going well with Major Henry. Having left his new post in charge of a small band, he had pushed up the Missouri early in the spring. Near the Great Falls, he had encountered a hostile party of Blackfeet. Defeated and forced to retreat, he was now waiting for reinforcements at the mouth of the Yellowstone. He had lost most of his horses, and asked that at least 50 should be purchased by Ashley from the Rees, for none could be procured in his vicinity. He inclined to the opinion that the treachery of the Assabonis during the previous fall and the recent resistance of the Blackfeet might be traced to the influence of the British traders, who naturally looked with disfavor upon the advance of American trappers toward the rich fur country of the Columbia and its tributaries. Plainly enough, the key to success for both parties was held by the Rees. They had the needed horses, and they held the river. Clinging to the hope that all might still be well, Ashley pushed on upstream. At sunset on the 29th of May, the party camped at the mouth of the Grand, some 5 or 6 miles below the Ree towns. In mid-afternoon of the next day, they rounded a bend where the river, flowing for some distance from east to west, turned abruptly south, and saw along the north bank, not more than half a mile ahead, a clutter of mud lodges and a portion of a newly built stockade that apparently surrounded the settlement. The Cordell crews were now taken aboard. Rifles were placed in easy reach of the men, and the boats, proceeding with oars and poles to a point in front of the lower village, were anchored in midstream. The two towns, set upon the flat lands in two convex bends that joined at the mouth of a little creek flowing from the north, were now visible to the men on the keelboats, and each of the 141 lodges was like a hornet's nest boiling forth its swarm. The guttural voices of men, the high-pitched, querulous cries of the squaws, and the barking of the dogs ran over the settlement. Many a youth who was making his first trip into the wilds thought wistfully of home in those tense moments, wondering why he had ever wished to leave. A Canadian boatman, who had been with Henry west of the Rockies, mounted the low roof of the Yellowstone's cabin, cupped his hands about his mouth, and shouted a greeting to the Rees. The hubbub among the nearby lodges subsided as he began to talk in the universal sign language of the plains, indicating the peaceful nature of the white men's mission and their wish to enter into a parley. The reply from the Rees seemed friendly, and seeing three Indians, two of whom were evidently chiefs, making their way toward the river bank, General Ashley, with two men, put off in a skiff, and met them on the strip of sandy beach. Now it happened, whether by good fortune or ill remained yet to be seen, that the man who accompanied the two chiefs to the parley was the notorious Edward Rose, the sound of whose name, mentioned at intervals from the Gulf of Mexico to the Three Forks of the Missouri, would at that time have awakened in sequence every note in the gamut of emotion, from contempt or fear to admiration. The son of a white trader and a half-breed Negro and Cherokee woman, Rose had achieved notoriety during the closing years of the 18th century as one of a band of pirates operating among the islands of the lower Mississippi. About the year 1807, the business of piracy seems to have become too hazardous even for a man of Rose's nature, and he had fled to the wild country, where a man might still be free to exercise his more robust talents. Within a year or two thereafter, thanks to shrewdness, audacity, undeniable courage, and a dusky skin, he had arisen to a position of great power among the Crow Indians, whose country lay south of the Yellowstone and west of the Powder River. In 1811, he was among the Rees when the overland Astorians under W.P. Hunt passed that way, and he had acted as a guide for the westbound party from the Missouri to the country of the Crows, with whom he remained until about 1820, when he had taken up his abode among the Rees. Recognizing the man at once by the disfiguring scar of an old cutlass wound across his nose, by reason of which he was generally known as Nez Cool, Ashley greeted him warmly, for the success of the present venture might easily depend upon the influence of this ex-pirate. For suitable consideration, Rose agreed to act as interpreter. The two parties squatted in a circle on the sand, and the pipe was passed in dignified silence, while the boat crews in midstream and the Indians, crowded on the roofs of their mud lodges, looked on in a hush of expectancy. When the preliminary ceremony was over, the general opened the parley. His heart was good, and he would speak straight words to his brothers, the Rees. The white men at the fort on the island of the Cedars, in the country of the Sioux, had told him things that were not good to hear. He was sad when he heard that there had been trouble between the Rees and the white men down yonder, and he had grieved to hear that a chief's son had been killed. All the way up from the island of the Cedars, he had been thinking hard about this thing, and he had feared that the Rees might feel angry at all white men because of what had happened. That would be wrong. It was not, however, a weak heart that made him speak so. His heart was very strong, for he was a big chief in his own country, and had he not 100 brave men out yonder on the boats? And each of them had grown up with a rifle and could shoot straight. He knew that if there should be trouble, many Rees would surely die, and that was not good to think about. He had passed that way a year ago, and had stopped to trade with the Rees. They had been very kind, and so his heart was warm toward them. His friends, who were at the mouth of the Yellowstone, needed more horses, which were not to be had up there, because the Assabonis were not rich as the Rees were. He wished to buy horses and go on to his friends. He had spoken. At the conclusion of the general's speech, the chiefs withdrew for a private conference, and when they returned, after what had seemed an interminable period to the anxious white men, they brought soft words. They too had been sad to hear of what had happened at the island of the Cedars, but three moons had grown old and died since then, and they no longer remembered. As the black trail of a prairie fire is made green with rain, so their hearts were green again. Those were all young men who had gone down yonder, wishing to be brave and being only foolish. Young men were like that, and would not listen to the old men whom many winters had made wise. They knew the big white chief before them spoke straight words. Also, their own tongues were not forked. They had many good horses, so many that one could not see them all with a look. They would trade. The Ree chiefs had spoken. Ashley now gave liberal gifts of scarlet cloth to the chiefs, and having agreed upon the merchandise that should be exchanged for the horses, which included a liberal supply of powder and ball, the white men returned to the boats. The tense silence that had clung about the party in midstream during the parley now gave way to singing and laughter and jest as the men made ready for the trade. Raw youths, out of sheer relief from dread, boasted valiantly. If the Rees wanted trouble, they knew very well where they could get it in plenty. Here, evidently, was a good example of crossing bridges before you reach them. In a few weeks now, the two parties would be united on the Yellowstone, and where was the parcel of niggers that could stop 200 white men? However, some of the older members of the party examined their rifle locks and were silent. Shortly after noon, the dickering began. It continued until sunset, and all the next day they haggled, Yankee shrewdness and Indian cunning contesting every point as the shaggy ponies came up for appraisal. By evening of the 1st of June, the desired number of animals had been purchased, and, uneasy with their hobbles, these milled and nickered on the beach. During the bartering, arrangements had been made for a party to set out with the herd at dawn for the cross-country trip to the mouth of the Yellowstone. 40 of the more dependable men were chosen for this task, and among the number was Jedediah Smith. As twilight deepened, the overland party made a semicircular camp, which, with the river, enclosed the herd, and a crescent of driftwood fires was glowing when the dark came down. End of chapter 3. Chapter 4 of The Splendid Wayfaring by John G. Neihardt. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Phil Schempf. The Battle. The campfires on the beach burned low, serving only to heighten the sense of companionship among the men, for it was a sultry night. Sounds carried far. A dog feast was being held somewhere in the upper village, and now and then the drums of the dance boomed through the soft dusk that was odorous with the young summer. At times the bass voices of the singing braves roared above the drums, and out of these soared the thin-spun notes of the squaws. Then the song would cease abruptly, and in the succeeding hush the droning of insect life and the mumble of the river would come back, like the scents of deer and common things. Sometimes a voyageur on the black boats would fling a snatch of song across the 40 yards of darkling water that separated the parties, and the camp on the shore would catch it up boisterously and set the horses neighing. Or some wag in the camp, remembering a current jest at the expense of a comrade out yonder, would hurl it at the boats, receiving a good-natured verbal drubbing for his pains, till the distant bluffs joined in the laughter. It was the time when men remember tales, and about those fires where yarns were being spun, the groups increased. "Go ahead and roll us out some of your doings that time across the plains," said a youngster, lounging in one of the larger groups, to an old-timer who had been to Santa Fe and had scars to show. "You seed sights that spree, eh?" "Well, we did," the old-timer replied. Far off, thunder mumbled as the party waited for the yarning to begin. "Some of 'em got their flints fixed this side of Pawnee Fork," so the old veteran began at length, "and a heap of mule meat went wolfing. Just by Little Arkansas, we saw the first Injun. Me and young Soames was ahead for meat, and I had hobbled the old mule and was approaching some goats, when I see the critters turn back their heads and jump right away for me. 'Hurrah, Dick,' I shouts. 'Hyar's brown skin a-comin'.' And off I makes for my mule. The young greenhorn sees the goats running up to him, and not being up to Injun ways, he blazes at the first and knocks him over. Just then, 7 redheads tops the bluff, and 7 Pawnees come a-screeching on us. I cuts the hobbles and jumps on the mule, and when I looks back, there was Dick Soames a-ramming a ball down his gun like mad, and the Injuns flinging their arrows at him pretty smart, I tell you. 'Hurrah, Dick, mind your hair!' And I ups old Greaser and let one Injun have it as was going plumb through the boy with his lance. He turned on his back handsome, and Dick gets the ball down at last and blazes away and drops another. Then we charged on 'em, and they clears off like running cows. I takes the hair off the heads of the 2 as we made meat of, and I do believe thar's some of them scalps on my leggings yet. Well, Dick was as full of arrows as a porcupine. One was sticking right through his cheek, and one in his meat bag, and 2 more bout his hump ribs. I tuck 'em all out slick, and away we goes to camp, and carrying the goat too. 'Injuns, Injuns,' was what the greenhorns yelled. 'We'll all be tackled tonight.
that's sartin. Tackled be damned, says I. Ain't we men too, and white at that? Well, as soon as the animals was unpacked, the governor sends out a strong guard, 7 boys and old hands at that. It was pretty nigh on sundown. The boys was driving in the animals when, ow, 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 we hears right behind the bluffs. And about a minute and a crowd of Injuns gallops down on the animals. Wah, warn't thar whoopin'. We jumps for the guns, but before we got to the fires, the Injuns was among the herd. I saw Ned Collier and his brother, who was in the hoss guard, let drive at 'em, but 20 Pawnees was around 'em before the smoke cleared from their guns. And when the crowd broke, the 2 boys was on the ground and their hair gone. Thar war an Englishman that just saved the herd. He had his mare, a regular buffler runner, picketed right handy. And as soon as he sees the fix, he jumps on her and rides right into the thick of the mules, and passes through 'em firing his 2-shot gun at the Injuns. And by gore, he made 2 come. The mules, which was snorting with funk and running before the Injuns, as soon as they see the Englishman's mare, followed her right back into the corral, and thar they was safe. 50 Pawnees came screeching after 'em, but we was ready that time, and the way we throwed 'em was something handsome. But 3 of the hoss guards got skeered, leastwise their mules did, and carried 'em off into the prairie, and the Injuns dashed after them. Then poor devils looked back, miserable now, I tell ye, with about 100 red varmints tearing after their hair, and whooping like mad. Young Jim Belcher was the last, and when he seed it was no use, and his time was nigh, he throwed himself off his mule, and standing as straight as a hickory wiping stick, he waves his hand to us, and blazes away at the first Injun as comes up, and drops him slick. But the next moment, you may guess, he died. We couldn't do nothing, for before our guns was loaded, all 3 was dead and their hair was gone. 5 of our boys got rubbed out that time, and 7 Injuns lay wolf's meat, while a many more went off gutshot, I'll lay. Howsoever, 5 of us went under, and the Pawnees made a raise of 12 mules. Wah! A low, incessant rumbling punctuated by an occasional earth-shaking bump far off in the dark northwest, now overlaid and dim the droning of the bugs. Coyotes yammered from the bluffs, and now and then re-dogs answered, howling.
"I'll say as how we are in for a right smart storm of rain and thunder," remarked Old Glass, arising and peering in the direction from whence a faint breath of wind had sprung out of a rising wall of murk that was slowly blotting out the stars. But the old-timer was in a mood for more yarning.
"Yes, sir," he was saying. "I went out that time old Jim lost his animals. 140 mules froze that night. Wah! Old Bill Lafory was thar, and the cussedest liar was Bill, for lies tumbled out of his mouth like boodins out of a buffler's stomach. He was the child as saw the putrefied forest. I mind when Bill come into St. Louis once, and one day he was fixed up like a dandy, and a settin' in the tavern where a lady says to him, 'Well, Mr. Lafory,' she says, 'I hear as how you're a great traveler.'
'Traveler, marm,' says Bill.
'This nigger's no traveler.
I are a trapper, marm.
A mountain man. Wah!' 'Well, Mr. Lafory,' says the lady, 'trappers is great travelers, and you goes over a sight of ground in your peregrinations, I'll be bound to say.' 'A sight, marm. This coon's gone over,' says Bill, 'if that's the way your stick floats. I've trapped beaver on Arkansas, and away up on Yallerstone. I've fought the Blackfeet, I've raised the hair of more'n 1 Apache, and made a Arapaho come afore now, and scalped my old head, marm, but I see the putrefied force,' says Bill. 'La, Mr. Lafory, a what?' says the lady. 'A putrefied force, marm,' says Bill, 'as sure as my rifle's got hind sights. One day we crossed a canyon and over a divide and got into a prairie where was green grass and green trees and green leaves on the trees and birds singing in the green leaves. And this in February, wah! Our animals was like to die when they see the green grass, and we all sung out, 'Hurrah for summer doings!' and I jest ups old Ginger at one of them singin' birds, and down come the critter elegant, its head spinnin' away from the body, but never stopped singin'. I finds it was Stone. Wah! And old Rube, what was with us, ups with his axe and lets drive at a cottonwood. Shrach! Goes the axe agin the tree, and out comes a bit of the blade as big as my hand. We looks at the animals, and thar they stood, shakin' over the grass, which I'm doggone if it warn't Stone too. And a feller as knowed everything came up, and he scrapes the trees with his butcher knife, and snaps the grass like pipe stems, and breaks the leaves like shells. He says it was putrefactions. La, Mr. Lafory, says the lady, did the leaves and grass smell bad?
Smell bad, marm, says Bill.
Would a polecat as was froze to stone smell bad? If it wasn't the putrefied perrary, ma'am, then this boss don't know fat cow from poor bull nohow.
Well, resumed the old-timer, when the roar of laughter had subsided, old Bill Lafory is gone under now. Went trappin' with a Frenchman who shot him for his bacca and traps. And that reminds me, has any of you'uns got any bacca? This beaver feels like chawin'.
A sudden gust of cool wind sent the embers scurrying and made the tent poles creak. The drums in the upper village no longer boomed, and the singing voices were stilled. Even the coyotes had ceased to cry. But as the men peered to the windward, into the murk where sheet lightning leaped fitfully, they heard, but a little way up the valley, the roaring of wind-embattled trees and the many-footed tumult of the charging rain. Scarcely had the tent pins been secured to windward and the horse guards taken their allotted stations about the excited herd when the storm broke. For hours it raged, and whoever peeped through a tent flap into the leaping flare of the lightning saw the world as a freshly painted monotone, smeared and blurred by the sweep of some huge brush dipped in electric blue. Lulled by the monotonous uproar of the storm, the camp slept at last, unconscious of a sinister activity in the villages. Shortly before the tempest struck, Edward Rose, who had been mingling with the dancers at the dog feast in the upper town, had stolen away from the revelers and put off in a canoe, paddled out to the keelboat Yellowstone. Taking Ashley aside, he had expressed doubts as to the good intentions of the Rees. What made him doubt? No more than a feeling he had that something was going wrong. Ashley, doubting Rose more than the Rees, had gone to bed little troubled. About midnight, the fury of the storm ceased, but the heavy downpour continued through the pitch-black hours. At 3:30, a dripping horse guard with bad news to tell awoke General Ashley. Aaron Stevens had been killed in the upper village, and it seemed probable that the Rees might begin an attack on the boats and the camp at any moment. The general sent the guard back to arouse the men on shore, and soon both parties, with their rifles in readiness, were peering anxiously into the black drench, and the dread was the greater in that nothing was visible. Time seemed to have grown sluggish with the rain chill and the drowse of the wee hours. It was the time when courage is at its lowest ebb, and the unresolved sighing of the rain was like a doleful prophecy to many a youth who now, for the first time, looked forward to battle. Slowly the minutes crawled downward. The droning of the rain lessened like the sound of a huge revolving wheel losing speed. By and by, the blackness began to dissolve into melancholy drab, and the lodges of the Ree loomed ominously in the drizzle. Tediously, the fading of the dark went on. The line of pickets surrounding the village was now visible. Nothing seemed to be moving there. Would anything happen after all? A sense of relief spread through the camp on shore. The men ventured to talk now, for the rain had ceased, and the familiar world was coming back with the slow light. Peacefully, the dusky boats swung at anchor in midstream. The horses stood quiet, huddled together with drooping necks and steaming hides. Soon the clouds would break, the sun would rise, the westward journey would begin, and laughter would be the end of the night's anxiety. The crack of a rifle and a spurt of smoke from a central point in the line of pickets brought the men to their feet. A horse screamed and floundered in the sand, and the herd whinnied and milled. Then, suddenly, the whole length of the Indian stockade roared into smoke, and simultaneously the wet beach spurted jets of sand. More horses went down screaming, and the hobbled herd plunged and jostled helplessly. Ben Sneed, Tully Piper, and Reed Gibson were down, the latter struggling to get up, the two others lying very still. General Ashley's lack of judgment in placing the horses and the overland party on the beach was now painfully apparent, for no way of retreat was open except toward the river. In the disorder that followed the first sweeping volley of the Rees, it was, curiously enough, not one of the old-timers who strove to draw the panicky men into some plan of action, but one of the youngest of the band, one who had never before heard the snarl of hostile bullets, Jedediah Smith. With the quiet courage and practical good sense that were to characterize his short but brilliant career, Jed turned his attention to the horses. He saw the enemy was bent upon wiping out the herd, and even in the excitement of the attack, he realized to the full the meaning of such a loss, both to the embattled party and to Henry far away on the Yellowstone. Calling John Matthews, John Collins, and Jim Daniels to aid him, he coolly set about the task of cutting the hobbles of the horses, intent upon driving them into the stream and forcing them to swim across to safety. By this time, the attack had settled down to a brisk running fire up and down the whole line of pickets and from the adjoining shelter of tumbled sandbanks. The Rees were armed with London fusils, furnished by British traders from the north, and it was Ashley's own powder and lead that now worked havoc with his plans. A great portion of the firing was being concentrated upon the animals, and many were going down. Some, feeling themselves free of the hobbles, raced neighing down the beach until a raking volley rolled them. Some few ran the gauntlet of the pickets unhurt and disappeared in the brush. When the three men whom he had summoned to his aid had been shot down, Smith gave up the attempt and joined in the battle. Joe Gardner was dead, and David Howard and George Flagler would never see St. Louis again. Anger at the sight of their comrades falling about them had served to steady the band, and all now were fighting like veterans. Phyllis, the black man, with a bullet hole through both legs, was busy loading and firing from a sitting position, cheerily announcing to his comrades now and then, "They ain't killed this nigga yet." Old Hugh Glass, bleeding from a hip wound, was plying the warrior's trade in a cool, methodical manner, always watching for an Indian's head to appear above the pickets or the patch of broken ground before he pressed the trigger. In much the same leisurely manner, the old-timer, who had survived many a scrimmage, went about the business of killing, now and then giving vent to his satisfaction with an Arapaho war whoop. It was a gallant stand-up fight, but it was hopeless from the first. Even when Ashley managed to put the skiffs ashore in spite of the shower of bullets that whipped the river, only seven of the party on the beach, two of those being seriously wounded, were willing to accept this means of escape. They had seen their comrades slain and their horses slaughtered. Their blood was up, and it was the blood of Kentuckians and Virginians and Pennsylvanians. Many of them were for storming the villages. If only the party on the boats would come and help. But the party on the boats, composed largely of French voyageurs, had already mutinied at Ashley's command to move inshore. Only with great difficulty had the general been able to induce a handful of the more courageous to land with the skiffs. Shortly after the skiffs pulled away, the shore party saw the keelboats dropping downstream and out of the fight. Deserted by their comrades, with half their number either dead or wounded, they realized at last the folly of further resistance. Leaping into the river, they struck out after the boats. Some, miscalculating the strength of the current, were swept away and lost. Some of the wounded went down and were seen no more. Several were shot as they swam and disappeared. It had been a struggle of magnificent courage against an alliance of treachery and cowardice, and the latter had won. Many of the youngsters, who had never fought before, were sobbing with rage and shame as, drenched and bleeding, they were dragged aboard by their faithless comrades. End of chapter 4. Chapter 5 of The Splendid Wayfaring by John G. Neihardt. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Phil Schempf. The Express to Henry. In a letter written 2 days after the battle to Major O'Fallon, Indian agent at Fort Atkinson, Ashley has set down for posterity the story of his woes. I ordered the boats landed at the first timber for the purpose of putting the men and boats in better situation to pass the villages in safety. So the letter continues after giving an account of the catastrophe. When my intentions were made known, to my surprise and mortification, I was told by the men, with but few exceptions, that under no circumstances would they make a second attempt to pass without a large reinforcement. Finding that no arguments that I could use would cause them to change their resolution, I commenced making arrangements for the security of my property. The men proposed that if I would descend the river to this place, near the mouth of the Moreau River, fortify the boats, or make any other defense for their security, they would remain with me until I could receive aid from Major Henry, or from some other quarter. I was compelled to agree to the proposition. On my arrival here, I found them as much determined to go lower. A resolution has been formed by the most of them to desert. I called for volunteers to remain with me under any circumstances, until I should receive the expected aid. 30 only volunteered. Among them were few boatmen. Consequently, I am compelled to send one boat back. After taking a part of her cargo on board this boat, Yellowstone Packet, the balance will be stored at the first fort below. The rest of the letter is concerned with the hope that government forces may be sent to make these people, the Rees, account for the outrage committed. We may imagine that it was a sullen and crestfallen party that landed at the first timber below the scene of disaster, and that nearly all refused to make an immediate attempt to pass the Ree towns is not strange. Those who had fought on shore had seen just how far their comrades could be trusted for support, and though Ashley's courage could not be questioned, his conspicuous lack of generalship was scarcely calculated to fill his men with confidence. While the boats were lying ashore at the first timber, a funeral service was held on board the keelboat Yellowstone for one John Gardner, who died of wounds shortly after the battle. We have old Hugh Glass's word for it, in a quaint letter dispatched by him to the dead boy's relatives, that Mr. Smith, a young man of our company, made a powerful prayer which moved us all greatly, and I am persuaded John died in peace. When the party refused to brave the Rees again, Ashley decided to summon Major Henry to his aid. But the distance to the mouth of the Yellowstone was close upon 200 miles as the crow flies, and considering the warlike mood of the Indian tribes at that time, the journey would be extremely hazardous. Who in the present mood of defeat that had settled upon the party would venture upon such a mission? Lining up his men, Ashley stated the case and made an appeal for volunteers. Only one man stepped out of the line. It was Jedediah Smith. Many wondered at this, and especially the old-timers. A young man who prayed like a parson and was more daring than the tough old mountain men. According to their experience, it didn't appear reasonable, and yet it was so. Notwithstanding Jed's expressed willingness to set forth without human companionship, Ashley insisted that the young man should not go alone, and finally succeeded in inducing one Baptiste, a French-Canadian trapper, to undertake the journey. Several of the horses that had managed to escape unwounded were found grazing in the timber that fringed the river, and these having been caught with little difficulty, preparations were made for the perilous cross-country ride. When the dark had fallen, the two men, each armed with a rifle, a pistol, and a hunting knife, mounted and rode westward out of the wood. Crossing the bottom and ascending a low range of bluffs, they saw behind them the broad, glooming valley, mysterious under the stars, and the glimmering strip that was the river. Far away in front, where the sky still held a pale reminder of the way the sun had gone, the prairie was a billowing dusk, the higher ridges looming vaguely in the wash of the starshine, vast distances, rather felt than seen. Spurring their tough little horses into a jog trot, and keeping the North Star above their right shoulders, Jed and the Frenchman forged on into an unknown land, heading for the Yellowstone that was somewhere out yonder, beyond the rim of the night. Wolves howled occasionally from the hilltops, and prairie owls raised their voices in the joyless, unearthly laughter that they know. Slowly the hours dragged on, and the men, riding silently, knee to knee, had little sense of progress, save when creek or coulee had to be crossed. The dipper, which is the timepiece of the heavens, seemed at times to have stuck on the upward swing about the pole. Yet suddenly it was up, and after that the increasing drowsiness against which the riders struggled gave speed to the starry clock. Thrice the Frenchman nodded, and thrice the swinging dipper leaped ahead for him. Nodding again, he raised his face to the sky and saw that the gloom was fading out in the vast hollow. Far across the rolling prairie to the rear, a faint streak of light was visible. The stars were burning low, and the landscape was beginning to lift out of the dusk. To their right, about a mile distant, a strip of timber marked the course of the Grand River, and riding thither, they descended into the valley and camped near the water where a patch of lush grass grew. Here, while the weary horses, tied to convenient bulberry bushes, fed contentedly, Jed and Baptiste ate a scanty breakfast and lay down to rest. The reaction from the tense experience of the previous morning, together with fatigue of the long night ride, soon sent them into a sound sleep. After what seemed no more than a few minutes, Jed, startled by a shrill neighing, leaped up, expecting to see the long line of pickets spouting smoke and a kicking tangle of wounded horses on the beach. Baptiste was also up, clutching his rifle and blinking at the peaceful valley in momentary bewilderment. In the mind of one rudely awakened from deep sleep, much may happen in the first wild instance of returning consciousness. Glancing at the stream, Jed marveled to see it flowing backwards. In the morning, it should be flowing toward the sun, and now it was most certainly flowing away from the morning that was no more than a half hour old. Then he knew they had slept all day, and that the sun was near to setting. Again the horses neighed, pricking their ears and gazing downstream with heads held high and tails up. A faint answer, as of many horses whinnying together, came back. Jed and Baptiste, now broad awake, saw a band of mounted Indian warriors filing diagonally down the flank of the bluff into the valley, no more than a half a mile to the east. There seemed to be at least 25 in the band, and it was plain now that the white men had been discovered, for after a moment of agitation the party separated, some dashing on down into the valley and out of sight among the trees, others hurrying back to the open prairie from whence they had just come. Fortunately, Jed and Baptiste had not unsaddled. They had intended to rest only long enough for the horses to feed, wishing to put as much space as possible between them and the Rees before they ventured on a good sound sleep. In a few moments, they had mounted and were plunging down the valley in and out among the plum thickets and the bulberry clumps. Now a steep bluff, closing in to the water's edge, forced them to ford the stream. Now for a few hundred yards they found good footing and made the most of it. Now again they were crashing through brush into another open space. They knew that the chances favored them, for their own horses were fresh after a long day of grazing, and doubtless their pursuers had been riding since daybreak. If they were able to gain only slightly during the few remaining hours of light, their chances for escaping in the dark would be good. The sun set, the twilight deepened, the stars came out. Reining their lathered and winded horses to a stand, they listened and heard only the sighing of a light breeze from the west. Nevertheless, if the Indians had persisted in the pursuit, which seemed likely, they could not be more than 3 or 4 miles behind. To ascend the sloping bluffs to the right and take the open prairie might bring the white men into contact with the party that had turned back to the highland. The bluffs to the left were precipitous, and to seek for a way out in that direction would involve much loss of time. Riding on down the valley at a walk, the two men were discussing the situation when Baptiste abruptly checked his horse and sniffed the air.
"Nom de Dieu," he whispered. "It is smoke. Rees, maybe. What we do now?"
Jed had also caught the smell of smoldering wood.
"Stay here with the horses," said he,
"and wait till I come back." Pushing cautiously through a wild cherry thicket and rounding the base of a bluff that jutted into the valley, he saw, about 100 yards ahead, the black mass of a cluster of cottonwoods, splashed with the glow of a dying fire. The light appeared to come from one point, and if this were true, the party camping there was probably small, for the great storm had brought a cold wave, and the night air was uncomfortably chill. Jed began to crawl toward the glow, feeling ahead of him as he went, and carefully removing any sticks that lay in his path, lest the snapping of one might arouse those about the fire. By and by, peering through a screen of brush, he saw the camp. At first glance, there seemed to be only one man, unmistakably a Ree. He was sitting cross-legged before a small heap of glowing embers, and he was evidently very sleepy, for his chin rested on his breast. But when Jed's eyes became adjusted to the glow, he saw that the man was not alone. Two other warriors, apparently sound asleep, lay sprawled upon the grass, with their feet to the fire, their bodies looming dim in the shadows. Three black bulks, horses by the sound of nipping and blowing that came from them, were barely visible in the deeper gloom of the cottonwoods. The villagers are probably short of meat, thought Jed, and this is a scouting party that has been looking for buffalo and is now waiting for the main body of hunters. Jed crawled back to the waiting Frenchman and reported what he had seen. "It's the safest way out, Baptiste," he said. "Our horses are a bit weary, and the Rees owe us many."
"Scalps, too," whispered the Frenchman, evidently gloating over the prospect for avenging the death of his comrades in the battle on the beach. Having agreed upon the plan of attack, they tied their horses and started walking until they rounded the jutting bluff. Here they cocked their rifles and began to crawl, Jed leading and carefully clearing the way as before. Soon they were peering through the brush within 20 yards of the camp. The man by the fire had not moved.
"Ready?" whispered Jed.
At the roar of his gun, the man who had been sitting leaped up with a wild yell, staggered, and fell across the embers. Simultaneously, the two shadowy sleepers scrambled to their feet, and at the sound of Baptiste's rifle, one went down. The other had seized his gun, but with a war whoop from the Frenchman, the white men broke from cover with drawn pistols. "Examine the horses, Baptiste," said Jed when the brief affair was over, "and choose the two best while I fetch ours." When, after a few minutes, Jed emerged from the dark leading the fagged animals, he found the Frenchman wiping three dripping scalps on the grass.
"It is bad enough to be forced to kill," said Smith, "but this is a heathen practice."
"Enfant des garces," exclaimed Baptiste, whose experience among the wild tribes of the north had developed the latent savagery that is in most men. "C'est la guerre. Moi, je suis mountain man."
"By and by, you mountain man too. Then, wah!"
He finished with a sweep of his reeking knife about his left fist by way of indicating the warrior's right of lifting hair, and with a chuckle of satisfaction tucked the hideous souvenirs under his belt and wiped his hands on his buckskin trousers. Hurriedly now they shifted their saddles to the taller and rangier horses of their fallen foes, leaving the third horse tied as they had found him. And half the night, as they pushed rapidly westward, they heard their own discarded animals, weary with the recent fight, neighing and floundering through the brush in the rear. Then the sounds ceased. When day broke, the riders ventured to ascend the bluffs by way of a winding gully, and halting on a summit that commanded a view of the river and prairie for many miles, they saw no living thing but a wolf loping along a distant ridge and a flock of crows hunting for a feast. They camped in a bulberry thicket, staked their horses out to graze, and spent the day resting, each taking his turn on guard while the other slept. When the valley began to fill with blue shadows, they set out again, following the stream. It was not yet midnight by the dipper when they reached the place where the river forks, and being uncertain as to which branch would be the better, they struck out across the open prairie on what they judged to be the shortest route to the Yellowstone. Guided by the North Star, they made good progress for several hours, when the sky became overcast. Still they pushed on, trusting to luck and to the sense of direction they still felt. But steadily the night grew blacker, and by a drizzling rain began to fall. It soon increased to a sodden, passionless downpour. Suddenly Jed became aware that, so far as he was concerned, there were but three directions, out and up and down. "No use going on, Baptiste," he said, "for we might find ourselves back at the forks in the morning." They staked their horses, and, sitting huddled together with their blankets over their heads, waited for the morning. It came at last, an ooze of drab light through the drifting rain. With heads and tails drooping and dripping, feet drawn together, the chilled horses presented a spectacle of misery. The emerging landscape would have been dismal enough in the sunlight, but now it was disheartening. The valley back yonder had been fat with the vigorous young summer. Here only bunch grass grew, and no brush was in sight as far as they could see to where the descending curtains of the rain shut out the world. A fire was out of the question. Chilled with the night's long drenching, they mounted and rode away at a jog trot, with their backs to the drowned dawn, while Baptiste muttered weird French oaths in his streaming whiskers. After hours, they found themselves in a gumbo plain, from whence at intervals grotesquely carven buttes soared flat-topped into the soppy haze. They were obliged to proceed at a walk now, for the earth was spongy and the hooves of the horses popped and sucked as they floundered on. No wood all that day, and when the dark came on, once more the men bivouacked in the mud and drench. The rain ceased in the night, and morning came with a golden sun that set the drear land steaming. Close on noon, they topped the gully-torn divide between the feeders of the Big and Little Missouri, and gazing westward, they saw afar the valley of the latter stream, a tangle of ragged gulches and rain-sculptured buttes. During the afternoon, Baptiste's rifle rolled a mountain sheep from a butte top, and that evening they feasted by the Little Missouri, where a plum thicket furnished fuel and a patch of slough grass offered a good night's grazing for the animals. Up and off at the first light, they crossed the river at the expense of another thorough soaking, for the stream was swollen with the recent rains, and when the horses plunged under in mid-current, the riders were forced to take to the water, gripping the saddle horn with one hand. But the soaking mattered little, so long as their screw-topped horns kept their powder dry. After hours of hard going in torrent-carved gulches, they emerged upon a lonesome upland and struck out northwest, crossing a number of creeks during the day, all of which flowed in a northerly direction, and they knew that they were now within the drainage area of the Yellowstone River. On the second day from the crossing of the Little Missouri, they began to follow the rugged valley of a small stream that led them in two more days into the valley of the Yellowstone. Game, grass, and wood were plentiful now, but Indians might also be plentiful, for the Assabonis, who had proven themselves unfriendly to Henry's party the year before, were known to wander over this region as far as the mouth of the Powder, where Absaroka, the country of the Crows, began. Once more, Jed and Baptiste traveled by night, and without encountering any further difficulties, they came, in the white dawn of the third day, to the junction of the two great rivers. An hour later, the gates of Henry's fort on the south bank of the Missouri, 4 miles above the mouth of the Yellowstone, swung open, and the two horsemen, bedraggled with their recent swim, rode into the enclosure and dismounted amid a throng of trappers, clamoring for news from Ashley. A tall, slender man, with keen, gray-blue eyes and the quiet, confident bearing of one who is born to command, pushed his way through the gathering of eager men, and for the first time Jedediah Smith and Major Henry met. Together these two withdrew to one of the larger log cabins of the post, leaving Baptiste to enlarge and embellish, in the picturesque mongrel tongue of the French voyageur, the tale of the battle with the Rees, and the long cross-country ride from the mouth of the Grand. End of chapter 5.